When I was in the second and third grade, my mother had a very good friend. Her name was Myrtle Depew, and they taught at the same school together, and they carpooled together for many years. And when I was in the second and third grade, I attended the school that they were teaching at because it just wasn't logistically feasible for me to go to a closer school at that time. And we had this 1952 Ford pickup. I don't know if you've ever driven in a 1952 Ford pickup, 3-speed on the column. And so there'd be my mother, Mrs. Depew, my brother and I in this 3-seat cab. There's 4 of us and there's no seat belts. And so I got to sit by mom, which meant that I got to sit back all the way. But because there wasn't enough room for all of us to sit back, my brother would sort of scoot up and just sit on the little edge of the seat, and then Mrs. Depew got to sit on this side, and we would go to school that way and back each day. But because of this connection, later when I was, I believe, between my junior and senior year in high school, I was able to get a job with Mr. Depew, who was a farmer. He needed an extra hired hand for the summer, and so he hired me for the really nice wage of about $1 an hour, which I thought was a great increase over the 50 cents an hour I had been paid a few years before working in the hay fields. But that connection helped me. That connection helped me. You see, it helped me to have a position I wouldn't have otherwise had. Well, we had a next-door neighbor who was also a friend of a lady she worked with at a bank, whose husband actually owned a nice store down the road about 7 miles away. And one summer, he needed a stock boy and someone to come in and help for the summer. And because of that connection, even though I didn't know him, didn't know his wife at the time, I was just told, hey, there's someone who wants to give you a job. He's heard about you. Would you like to go down and get a job? Yeah, I want to go get a job. And I think I got paid $1.85 for that one an hour. And that was just like, I was gravy training it, you know. Well, I was in college. And somehow I became friends with the head resident assistant in our dormitory, and he happened to be the most politically powerful student in our college. And when there came an opening for an assistant at the mailbox and phone answering little section of the dormitory, I got picked. I got picked. And I could tell you about a lot of other jobs I got because I had a connection. I'd like to think that I did well at these jobs and was qualified for them, and my first year I was teaching, I had 13 offers for jobs, and I don't think I had any connections on those. So maybe I got those on merit. But nevertheless, it's important to have connections sometimes. I think about a modern computer. And when I say a modern computer, I mean one made today, because all others are, of course, obsolete and ancient by now. But they have millions, and I think today billions, of transistors and components. And all of these components have to be joined together perfectly for this machine to operate and to function properly. Now, clearly, all these components could have not come together by accident, but rather by design. By a design that takes teams of workers, working thousands of hours each to bring all these components together to make something that works properly and usefully. I believe that our human bodies are much more complex than computers. And they also reveal design, a master design, a design that allows for all the parts to work harmoniously together. And today, we want to look at the spiritual harmony a little bit between the body and the mind, or the body and the spirit. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Acts chapter 24. Acts chapter 24. And I'm going to give you preachers a good outline. Actually, I'm not Paul is. Acts 24. Acts chapter 24. And verse 24, and after certain days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he, that is Paul, reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, "Go thy way for this time, when I have a convenient season, I will call for thee." Now there you go, preachers. You're doing your homiletics, and you want a good 3-point sermon, and it's righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come. But I want you to notice that in the message of Paul, in this vital message of Paul, that one of the main components of his message was the message of temperance. And don't we associate temperance with health reform, friends? Yes. I believe we do. Temperance is a part of the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5. Galatians 5, verse 23. Meekness, what else?
Temperance.
Against such there is no law. God wants us to have temperance also. And in fact, in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 6, the Apostle Peter puts it in his ladder of progression in Christian growth and sanctification. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 6. Peter says, and to knowledge, what are we to add?
Temperance.
So temperance plays a vital role here. But this temperance, do you hear me?
Yes, please.
This temperance may not be what you think it is, strictly speaking. Now, the Greek word that is translated temperance is enkaratia, and it means mastery or self-control. It comes from two words that mean in strength or in control of strength. And I want to look at another verse now where we have this concept brought in, and that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. Paul says, know ye not? He's saying in our common vernacular, don't you know? Get it? Don't you know? Don't you know that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain.
Amen.
Now, I used to be a track runner, and there's only one person gets to be first. I know that. And you run, and you run hard. But in this race, we can all be first.
Amen.
Isn't that right? In our race? But he says this, and he's making an analogy between the temporal, world, and the Christian experience. And he says in verse 25, he says, every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in what?
All things.
Now, again, you know, this concept of being temperate means to have mastery or self-control. And so he says, everyone that wants mastery, must have self-control. He says, now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. I'm not like a shadow boxer, he says. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway. In the book Acts of the Apostles, on page 314, Ellen White has this to say. She says, the apostle compares himself to a man running in a race, straining every nerve to win the prize. I therefore so run, he says, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway. That he might not run uncertainly or at random in the Christian race, Paul subjected himself to severe training. The words I keep under my body literally means to beat back by severe discipline the desires, impulses, and passions. Friends, to be able to do that, you have to have self-control and mastery. Now, there's another verse that I think that we need to add in here this morning. That's in the book of Titus. Titus chapter 2 and verse 2. Titus chapter 2 and verse 2. Titus is the last of those five T books, right? 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, and then Titus. That's the easy way to remember those books. There's five T's. Titus. I'll read verse 1. He says, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged man may be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. And this word temperate here is from the Greek word sophron, and it means well-minded or well-hearted. And it's also, in fact, translated in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2 as sober. Sober. Now, there's a point that we need to have a clear understanding on, and that is, what am I going to be the master over? Or what is this self-control really about? What will I have this self-control over? Well, I like to exercise, and I won't quite say I'm addicted to all those endorphins and dopamines and things that your body produces, but I certainly like them. Maybe you do too. But I got on an exercise program a couple years ago, and I was keeping a record of my exercise matrix. And for 557 straight days, I either met or exceeded my exercise and movement goals. You say, well, how'd you do it on Sabbath? Well, after the sun sets down, you know, you do your exercise, you take your hike, you go to the gym or whatever. And I did that for 557 days. I'm going to tell you, that took some self-control. Because there were a lot of days that it was late at night, I was working late at night, or something had happened, I had to travel, an emergency happened, and it's 11:30 at night. I still need to get 30 minutes of exercise in. See? But in retrospect, maybe that wasn't the best thing to do. You see? I mean, the point I'm making is that we can have a certain kind of self-control, but it might not necessarily be temperate or temperance in the most literal sense. I mean, it could be in the most literal sense, but maybe not in the sense that we want it to be. Because the true temperance is that self-control or mastery which leads to the right physical and moral choices. You know, I mean, I could have self-control. I'm going to tell you, for the next 557 days, I'm not going to take a bath. Okay? That probably would take some self-control. And no one, of course, would want to be here with me today. But you see what I'm saying? We can have a certain type of self-control. But what is the self? Or what are the things that we're taking mastery of? You know, we can have control. There's a lot of people who are very disciplined. There are athletes who have a very rigid, disciplined routine, and they follow it religiously. But that doesn't mean it's temperance in the sense that we as Christians understand. Now, I know that you have heard this before, that true temperance teaches us to dispense entirely with everything hurtful and to use judiciously that which is helpful. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 562. As Christians, I ask you the question, what are we really to have mastery over? Where is the battle really fought? I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles now to Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Beloved, there will be a day that we will be translated and glorified in the flesh. But we have to be first renewed in our mind through the new birth and the experience of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The battlefield today is not our flesh. You know, the Bible never says to take the flesh of Christ Jesus, because we have his flesh already. He accepted our flesh and our nature. But the Bible says to let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. We are to have the mind of Christ. And he says here to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And you know that word transformed in the Greek is metamorpho, and we use it today to illustrate the dynamic transformation, for instance, of a caterpillar to a butterfly or a moth. And it's a very different experience, you know, from one to the other, isn't it? In fact, when we were at the general conference session, Brother Tim Standish was showing a video. In fact, I think we made a purchase of that video, didn't we, on metamorphosis. And for many years, they didn't really know what was happening in that little chrysala. But some scientists decided they would get this little chrysalis and put it through I don't know if it was an MRI or a CT machine or both, and they started studying what was going on every day. It was amazing. It was amazing. This thing basically goes down to, not quite like soup, but, and then it just rebuilds itself in something different. Very different. Very different. And yes, as Brother Mike says, very organized. But God wants a real change in us. And it's true, he wants my body to be, he wants me to give my body as a living sacrifice. I should stand up here and I should be able to look down and see my toes. I should be able to stand up here and I should be able to do the little Elvis squat, you know. Hopefully I'll be able to still do that in a few more years. But the point I'm making is that we should do what we can physically. That's true. There's nothing wrong with that, and it's an important thing, and that's really what we're really talking about here today to a great degree. But I'm trying to say that there's a connection here, and we're going to get to that connection in a minute. But the battle is for our mind. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, Paul says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." 2 Corinthians 10:3. Now verse 4. He says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." Now you notice in verse 3, he says, "Though we were in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." And then in verse 4, he mentions that our warfare is not carnal. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. It's interesting because the word that's translated flesh is the Greek word sarx, and just simply means flesh or the body. But the word carnal is sarkikos, and it means pertaining to the flesh. It's just from sarx. And so when you see that word carnal there, it simply just means flesh again. It's just another way of stating it. He says, our weapons are not of the flesh. Our weapons, friends, are the thoughts and the words of Christ. And the battle is in the mind. Another translation says this, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God." Let me just stop there. Is the doctrine of the Trinity a speculation and something that wars against the knowledge of God? Friends, that's part of our job right now, is to take care of that. It's to go to war against it. And it says, "And we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ." Now, we are a two-component person. We are the dust of the ground, we are the body, and we are the mind or the spirit, right? We all understand that mind and spirit are basically interchangeable concepts, right? No problem on that. Good. So I want to ask you one. Which one should rule? Which one should have the mastery? It is the mind or the spirit that must have mastery. In Patriarchs and Prophets on page 562, we find these interesting and helpful words. She says, "True temperance teaches us to dispense entirely with everything hurtful and to use judiciously that which is healthful." Oh, we just read that a little bit ago, didn't we? Right?
We did. Good.
But now we're getting the context of it a little bit more. She says, "There are few who realize, as they should, how much their habits of diet have to do with their health, their character." Wait a minute. My diet has something to do with my character? That's what it says. "Their usefulness in this world, and perhaps most importantly, their eternal destiny. The appetite should ever be in subjection to the moral and intellectual powers. The body should be the servant to the mind and not the mind to the body." You see, beloved, God wants to take our minds, and He wants to make them ruler of our soul, so that the mind, the spirit, controls the body. Satan, on the other hand, he tries to take the lust of the flesh and control the spirit with it. That's right. We are also told that the relation which exists between the mind and the body is very intimate. When one is affected, the other sympathizes. You see, this, friends, is the most important connection as human beings within, you know, internally within ourselves that we have, is this connection between the mind and the body. And it is real. It is real. Let me just give you a simple example. I'm driving down the road one day and a car in front of me, it hits a possum. And that possum just explodes. And I see all that, you know, those blood and guts. And you know what happens? I get sick in my stomach. That possum didn't come up and shake me or do anything to me, did it? But there was something about my mind that got my body activated, didn't it? Sure. And you know, some of you, if I was to ask you to come up here on the spur of the moment and give a testimony or give a Bible study right now, your stomach might be getting a little shaky, you know, at the spur of the moment, because there's a sympathy between the mind and the body. The condition of the mind affects the health of the physical system. If the mind is free and happy from a consciousness of right doing and a sense of satisfaction in causing happiness to others, it creates a cheerfulness that will react upon the whole system, causing a freer circulation of the blood and a toning up of the entire body. The blessing of God is a healing power, and those who are abundant in benefiting others will realize that wondrous blessing in both heart and life. And, of course, this is bringing in the issue of active service, isn't it?
It is.
As we are going out and helping other people, it has a healthful effect to us. You know, it's not going down the gym and lifting these weights, and that's not wrong of itself. I do it. But I'm just saying that's not what really is going to give me the tone I need. It's doing this work, and it's having this knowledge that my mind is free and happy from the fact that I know I'm conscientiously doing what is right. And friends, when you are laboring under a load of sin, and you know sin's in your life, and you know there's that besetting sin that's really struggling, that's causing you to struggle, it will just destroy you.
Mm-hmm.
It will destroy you.
So,
yes, ma'am.
Can you read Isaiah 58?
I can't right now, but I'll get it in a little bit. Is that okay?
Okay.
No, I'm not going to read it, but I'll get it in a little bit, but I have to continue my thought here. Is that okay? Thank you. So this is from, I'm sorry, I didn't give you the whole slide there, did I?
No.
Okay, here we go. Here's the last part again. The blessing of God is a healing power, and those who are abundant in benefiting others will realize that wondrous blessing in both heart and life. And that's from Ellen White's Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene, page 13. From that same work, we have these words. Some have sneered at health reform and have said it was all unnecessary, that it is an excitement which tended to divert minds from present truth. They have said that matters were carried to extremes. Such do not know what they are talking about. While men and women professing godliness are diseased from the crown of the head to the sole of the feet, while their physical, mental, and moral energies are enfeebled through gratification of depraved appetite and excessive labor, how can they weigh the evidences of truth and comprehend the requirements of God? Now, friends, it's getting really close to home, isn't it? She's telling us that if we are not health reform, not just simply minded, but practiced people, then we will not be able to understand and properly weigh the evidences of truth and comprehend the requirements of God. And then she says further these important words: if their moral and intellectual faculties are beclouded, they cannot appreciate the value of the atonement or the exalted character of the work of God, nor delight in the study of His Word.
Amen.
Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene, pages 153 and 154. Beloved, we are to be people of the atonement. Isn't that right? People of the atonement. And we cannot understand the exalted character of the work of God or value the atonement when our minds just aren't operating right. It's like our minds, when we're not on health reform, it's like our computers when they're just full of viruses, you know, and those little bots and things that people throw on sometimes if we're not careful and don't have our computers protected. You know, the thing just slows down, it bogs down, it just can't get through things, right? And this is why, friends, above all other reasons, we need health reform. Because we ourselves will not be able to value the atonement. And I dare say we will not participate in the atonement. The real crux of the matter is this. We will not be able to properly discern spiritual matters if we are not following health reform as it is our pleasure to do. And you know, I found it interesting that of the people who accept this message we call the truth about God, I don't find many people who are meat eaters who do it.
Mm-hmm.
I find that many of the people, and I think a larger percentage of the people who accept this message than those who don't within the Advent community, more the people who do, they are vegans and people who are health reform minded. Because they have that mind that gives them a clarity to be able to see this truth where other people don't. The critical nature, and again I say the most critical nature of this, is seen in this statement, from Testimonies, Volume 7, page 136. The light God has given on health reform is for our salvation and the salvation of the world. Amen. God didn't give this health reform message, friends, just so that we could win some prize or be noted as being the healthy people of the country. It involves salvation because when you can't think right, and salvation is a process that is dependent upon faith, and faith is a believing, thinking process. If you can't think and you can't have faith, you can't be saved, friends. I can't make it any clearer than Sister White here did in this very statement. It is vital. It is vital. Now, you might say, but Brother Allen, salvation is outlined for us in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. And maybe we should read that. He says, for by grace are you saved through your fork and spoon. No, he doesn't say that either, does he? But it's through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of health reform, lest any man boast. So how do we reconcile this? Beloved, we need to understand that salvation is by grace through faith alone. But if we do not have minds that can comprehend things, if our systems are so beclouded that we don't understand salvation, we can't understand the atoning work of Christ right now, then we can't reach out and grasp hold of his arm of faith. And it won't happen. And we might think that we can today, but I'm going to tell you, friends, we are coming to a time, and mark this point with care, we are coming to a time in the history of this earth, and as Brother Andy, who's not here, where's Brother Andy? Uh-oh. We're coming to a time, as Brother Andy said, that we're before the near, right? Or something like that. What did he say yesterday? We're before the near?
Soon.
We're before soon, right. We're before soon. We're there. We're going to face the greatest crisis that has ever been brought before humanity. Yes. No generation will have ever faced the fierce assaults that we're going to face. Mm-hmm. No generation is going to be tempted like we will be tempted and tried in these last few days. And I'm going to tell you, only the people who know their God will be strong and do exploits at that time. Only the people who have this abiding, I mean deep, trusting faith in God at this time are going to go through.
Amen.
And we're not going to be able to have that, beloved, I believe, with all my heart. We won't be able to have that if we're not trying to live health reform. Now, I realize, look, not everybody was born the same. Not everybody has had the same experiences. You may not be able to be as healthy as I am today. You may have physical problems that prevent you from being as healthy as I am. And I may have problems that prevent me from being as healthy as some of you. That could be, right? People have injuries. People have genetic issues. But here's the point. We do what we can do, and God will make up the difference, friends. You know, he is faithful. He is not some tyrant. He's not some ogre who's just waiting to destroy us. He is merciful. He loves us so much that he gave his only begotten son to die for us. And he wants us to come up to his beautiful level. He doesn't want us to stay down in the mire and the muck. He wants to lift us up. And health reform was given not to be a burden to us, but a blessing to us. But I want to tell you, friends, we are in a trying time. And if you don't believe that we're in a trying time, I want you to notice this paragraph. And I hope you can digest it. I have been shown that Satan has not been stupid and careless for these many years since his fall, but has been learning. He has grown more artful. His plans are laid deeper and are more covered with a religious garment to hide their deformity. The power of Satan now to tempt and deceive is tenfold greater than it was in the days of the apostles. Now, I didn't put the date of Spiritual Gifts, Volume 2 here, but somebody help me with the date of that. Is that about 1864?
1860s, yeah.
Yeah, 1860s, right? So give Satan another 150 years. What's happened? What's happened? She says that his power at that time was tenfold more than in the days of the apostles. I don't know how much more it would be today. His power has increased and will increase until it is taken away. His wrath and hate grows stronger as his time to work draws near its close. And so, beloved, we need every advantage we can get. And we need to understand this vital connection between our minds and our bodies. And we need the health reform to be able to make that connection, you see.
Amen.
Also from Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene, page 52. In order to preserve health, temperance in all things is necessary. Temperance in labor, temperance in eating and drinking. Our Heavenly Father sent the light of health reform to guard against the evils resulting from a debased appetite, that those who love purity and holiness may know how to use with discretion the good things which He has provided for them, and that by exercising temperance in daily life, they may be sanctified through the truth. I know that the sentence goes on beyond evils. The evil she specifically mentions here is a debased appetite. But the fact is that health reform was sent to guard us against evil.
That's right.
Isn't that right? So I'm so thankful for that. So in summary, the biblical concept of temperance means to be in control. But those living in the last days especially need self-control in all things, because the mind and the body sympathize with each other. And the only way to have a clear, healthy mind, one that can understand vital spiritual issues for today, is to be in the best health possible. Now again, we understand that there are those who are maybe restricted in some way from having even normal health, what we call normal health. They don't get left out, friends. No. Not a thousand times no, because God knows our frame. He knows that we are dust. And again, He is not a tyrant or expects something from us which He will not provide, but He will in His mercy make up every difference. Now that doesn't leave us to use God's mercy as an excuse for transgression. God's grace cannot be presumed upon. That is disgrace. But today, we can see the need to live health reform. And I'd like to challenge you, will you begin anew today to clean up old habits and problems and bring them to Jesus? And now I'd like to close with Isaiah 58. And which verse particularly did you want me to share? Isaiah 58, 8, yes. Well, the promise is based upon a condition, which we should read it also. It's verse 7. It says, speaking of the fast that he wants, he says, "Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house, when thou seest the naked, that thou cover him? And I think this is one we miss out on sometimes, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh." We can go out and we can save the world, friends, but we don't even deal with our own flesh, our own family sometimes. We have family members in need, and it's like, well, we can't help them. They've already heard the truth. But friends, we can't hide ourselves from our own flesh. They need our help too. And she says, if we will do these things, or the prophet says, Isaiah says, if we will do these things, then shall thy light break forth as in the morning, and thy health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. What a blessing. I'd like to invite you to pray with me. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the blessings of this morning. We thank you, Father, for the gift of Jesus and the promise of salvation through grace by faith. Father, you've made salvation on a level that we can all accept and understand and relate to. It's true, we all can't do the same things, and there are people, and I think of some dear ones who are with us right now in the internet, and maybe we can't see or maybe we can't walk well. But we can believe, and we can believe. And through that faith, Father, you will accept us into your kingdom. But we want to have the faith that pleases you, that will stand through these times. And so you've given us health reform, and you will bring each and every one of us to the place that we need to be, where we can clearly think about these things, that as Paul says, as we run in this race, that we run for the mastery, and that we bring every thought into obedience to the mind of Jesus Christ. So please bless us, Father, that if there are areas that we know we haven't done so well in, it's time to get going. Because, Father, I mean, of us here, and I think of myself first and foremost, we have a knowledge of these truths. We're not ignorant of the laws of health. We're not ignorant of the effects of inactivity. We're not ignorant of the effects of high sugar diets and animal product diets and all these things. We pretty much know a lot of this already, Father. Help us to live these things to gain the mastery of these things so that our minds and our bodies can connect properly. Please bless us with power from on high, Father, because we can do nothing of ourselves, but we open ourselves up to you through Jesus, and we thank you in his precious name. Amen.